Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. We've received apologies this morning from Murdo Fraser. This morning we will continue our inquiry into the impact of the pandemic on the Scottish labour market. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Marek Zemanek, Senior Policy Advisor from the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development, Bea Boylaw, Research Economist, and Jonathan Cribb, Associate Director of the Institute for Fiscal Studies, David Fares, Executive Director of Regulatory Policy Analysis and Advice, and from the Pensions Regulator, who joins us in person, and also Dr. Liz Cameron, CBE, Director and Chief Executive of the Scottish Chamber of Commerce, who also joins us in person. Welcome. Thank you for giving us all your time this morning and also for all your written submissions. We estimate that this session will run up to about 20 past 10 and each member should have approximately 11 minutes each to speak to the panel and to ask their questions. But please just catch my eye if you have a question in the meantime. For the witnesses who are attending remotely this morning, if you'd like to respond to an issue that is being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we'll bring you in. I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak, and I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interests of brevity. I'll now turn to questions, but sorry, just firstly, can I just ask witnesses to introduce themselves? Can I start with David?
So David Fares, Executive Director of Regulatory Policy Analysis and Advice at the Pensions Regulator.
Thank you. Liz?
Liz Cameron, Director and Chief Executive of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce.
Thank you very much. Jonathan Cribb?
Hi, I'm Jonathan Cribb. I'm an Associate Director of the Institute for Fiscal Studies and I'm the Head of our Retirement Savings and Ageing Research.
Thank you, Jonathan. B? Sorry, yep. B, could you hear me? Would you like to introduce yourself? I think there might be a technical issue there. Marek, can I bring you in?
Hi, good morning. My name is Marek Zemanek. I am the Senior Public Policy Advisor for the CIPD. We are the professional body for HR and development.
Thank you. B, Bolo, could you raise your hand if you can hear me? Okay, I think we've got a bit of a technical issue with one of the witnesses, but I'll just move on to questions, if I may. I think because B can't hear at the moment, if I could start with you, Jonathan. Can you provide an idea of what the early retirement trends were prior to the pandemic? And has there been changes to trends previously following global shocks, such as the 2008 global recession?
Yeah, okay. So I think the broad picture prior to the pandemic was decades, actually, of people working longer into their 50s and 60s and fewer people retiring early. We know a little bit about why that was happening. There are kind of generation-on-generational increases in women working in their 30s and 40s while they have dependent children, and those fed into higher rates of employment in people's 50s and 60s as well. Women also face a much higher state pension age now than they did 12 years ago. That's pushed up employment. And for men, it's been a bit of recovery from huge declines in employment in people's 50s and 60s in the 1980s and deindustrialization, and that's kind of recovered since the mid-1980s. So this has all been on big upward trends. Actually, the employment rate, so the 2008 recession was, the biggest recession since the 1920s. But if you looked at the employment of people in their 50s and 60s, you really didn't see it. And so that was quite robust. And that really is very different to the set of issues around this time. That being said, the Great Recession, it was all about unemployment, Whereas, you know, as we will come on to this time, it's about kind of economic inactivity and people not even searching for work, being essentially out of the labour force entirely.
Thanks, Jonathan. Yes, I think that's really interesting. And one of the things that we've been considering as a committee brings me on to my next question. Do you think this shift into early retirement will be sustained as we loom into perhaps another recession and the cost of living crisis that we've not experienced in over 40 years, that it may reverse the trend because maybe people won't be able to afford to retire?
Yeah, I think there's a good... So, firstly, we don't know because... you know, we haven't experienced inflation like this in 40 years. The structure of the labour market, of the economy, full stop, is very different to how it was back then. And people's health, for example, is very different to what it was back then. There's a good case to be made that the cost of living crisis will, you know, really affect the incomes of people in these age groups into their 50s and 60s. I think that could well make people regret, some people regret their retirement decision because they have less money than they can thought they would have. That being said, whether it actually leads to people going back into work, I think is another matter, because there are really very low rates of returning to work, particularly people in their early 60s. And it's not totally easy to do so.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we did have technical issues, but I think, B. Bolo, you are with us now and you can hear. Is that correct?
Hi. Yeah, sorry, I can hear.
Great.
I can hear you now.
Fantastic. Did you hear the previous questions that I was just asking to Jonathan? I don't know if you wanted to add anything to that.
I think Jonathan said everything that I would have
That's
said
great.
As well.
Okay, great. Great that you're with us at the moment. If I can move on to Dr. Liz Cameron from the Scottish Chamber of Commerce. Do you think the pandemic and the disruption to education has had an impact on the pipeline for the skills that employers need now or in the near future?
A quick answer would be absolutely yes, it has. Because we are seeing two different age groups here and two different talent pools, one being the very, very young people and one at the other end of the scale in the 60-plus age group, which we've just been discussing. But as far as the younger end of the market is concerned, we are seeing students and younger people going into education because in some cases they do not see and identify any opportunities for them right now, and there's a level of disillusionment as well. Now, from a business point of view, we have got to tackle that ourselves in terms of bringing in more young people and bring them perhaps straight from school. And I think that that's, you know, this element of training and reskilling and upskilling. There's messages going out that in some cases are driving young people away from the marketplace completely. Mm-hmm. And we can't afford, because it really is going to be an absolute lost generation if we don't actually bring it back. So I think it is important that whilst education, whether it be in further higher education, is absolutely important, but it's not the only choice that younger people have. And we really would like to see more effort from us as business community, as well as government and government support and information to the young people, because we are seeing now universities overloaded with young people, yep. Colleges overloaded, accommodation difficulties. We want them out into the industrial marketplace. And we are doing everything we can in terms of changing our model and how we go about recruiting. Because the model of young people now, they are demanding flexible working. Mm. They are demanding opportunities and career progression. They are demanding training. Mm. So I think it's quite important that we actually focus on that group with some urgency.
Yeah, absolutely. I do know, just going from South Ayrshire's point of view, I think 98% of school leavers at the moment are going into positive destinations, either being university or college or employment. And it's just that joined up thinking between the colleges, the schools and the businesses as well. Is there anything that you think that we could be doing better, the Scottish Government, to help with that?
Specifically for young people?
Yes.
I think it would be worth our while, because we've got, you know, I think Scotland's very, very good in terms of our apprenticeship programmes. What we, in fact, are probably ahead of other parts of the United Kingdom in that respect. But I would like to see, I think, a stronger focus from from the business community and more of a partnership approach with the Scottish Government, so that this positive destination that you referred to, you know, in work, in employment, in training, is absolutely a real opportunity. And I don't think that that's highlighted sufficiently enough by government and economic development agencies and educationalists, because, you know, many, many individuals go in to do, whether it's apprenticeships or whether it's a graduate recruitment, internships. These are great opportunities where young people can come into the workplace and can learn real skills whilst continuing with their further and higher education. So I think that we'd like to see how are we investing in either that young person, where is the funding going, and are we clear that, and I don't have the answers to any of this, so I do apologise, but are we clear that we are getting real good value for money and not just putting colleges and universities under such a strain that there are young people that are missing that opportunity? So I think a little bit more. Now, whether, and I'm throwing this on the table, whether, you know, if I go back many, many decades, you know, businesses have had to change in the last 2-3 years, remarkably so. They've been forced to in some cases. So therefore, I'm seeing a return, and it's a good, healthy return, to investing more in training and investing more in our people, whether that's at recruitment level or retention level. So is there something that more that we can do to encourage more businesses, particularly the small and medium-sized businesses, as we are heading into an absolute crisis that goes way beyond COVID now? Is there something from the taxation perspective, or is there something that we should be looking at in terms of where are we investing what will be a reduced pot from governments? Are we investing in the right area? So this is a time, I think, to try different models, because we're not alone in Scotland. Globally, there is a skills crisis. Globally, there is a labour market crisis. But in Scotland, even before COVID, we had Brexit, and even before that, we've got a labour market population issue.
Yeah, thank you. That's really interesting. Could I bring in Marek? Did you want to add anything to that?
Yes, thank you. I think Jonathan made a very good point when he was talking about early retirement and the cost of living crisis. There is, of course, a difference between trying to bring people who have retired early back into the labour market, and the other side of the coin is making sure that fewer people retire early in the first place. But recruitment and retention are, of course, two sides of the same coin. I think it remains to be seen whether the cost of living crisis acts as a sort of push to try and push people back into the labour market. Traditionally, it's been very difficult to bring people retired early back into the labour market, as Jonathan said. But I think it's probably likely that it will act as a sort of break to try and discourage people from retiring a little bit earlier. But all points to the importance of the focus on retention and what employers can do to make sure that particularly older workers have the support systems in place and their preferences catered to ensure that they can work for as long as they want to. And that's all about flexibility, it's about skills development as well. That's, of course, it's about health and well-being as well. But we can explore those reasons as the session goes on.
Thank you. I'm just going to bring in Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Camilla. Well, this is more... Good morning, Liz. Nice to meet you. This is more for you, talking about young people and their attitude to work, getting into the workplace. I'm looking at the CIPD figures here just now, and the question was asked, my job offers good opportunities for career progression. And they were asked to agree or disagree to that. I find it astonishing that 16 to 17-year-old, 18 to 19-year-old, 20 to 24-year-old, there's very few in that age category who see career opportunities developing. And yet, as you get up the older age scales, you're in your 40s and 50s and 60s and even beyond the 60s, the 65s, where they see much greater progression. Mm-hmm. Why do our young people feel as though there is no opportunity for them to progress?
I'm not sure there's a straight answer to that question. I'm not avoiding it at all, because I think it depends, A, in the business, it depends on the young person. And I did some work previously with career graduates going into employment market. And at that point in time, they were quite clear that their their skills were not being utilised by businesses sufficiently enough, and that was causing them to be disappointed and wanting to move into other areas. You know, I think that, and I think it's a responsibility for business here in terms of that career progression. We have got to, where we can, and some smaller businesses do not have a defined career progression path, but there's others who do, and I think that we've got to, and I do think that we are changing quite substantially, that view that career progression is about the individual. Mm. And therefore, a young person comes, let's say I'll take Scottish Chambers as a perfect example. You know, I don't have a straight career progression path. I'm a small business employing 8 people. Having said that, we bring young people in because for them and for us, their career progression is getting that skill set with SCC and then moving on to bigger and better things. And I think that attitudinal issue with many small businesses that needs to come up on the agenda a lot higher than it is just now, because for young people coming in and not seeing that career progression, you know, we're not informing, we're not communicating, and we're not actually, I think, and I'm being critical of us, I guess, in this respect, we need to do more to ensure that a career progression does not mean that you stick with the same company and utilise the opportunity in any business to gain that skill. But that needs to be developed, and we need to train and we need to support young people. And I think that not just COVID, but as I say, the labour market crisis in Scotland has forced, and I'm using the word forced, many, many businesses to change completely their working practices, which is good in some cases. But there are many others, especially in the corporate world, who already have very effective, very productive and really high-class career progression roles. So whether it's when someone comes in at 20, 24, they don't see it, that's an issue that needs to be addressed. But then the older age group you describe, they are going through that career progression trail. So it's a little bit also about potentially mentoring with the, you know, the other employees mentoring our younger people in employment in terms of this is what it could happen.
Grant, thank you. I'll go back to the convener because I jumped the queue.
Thank you. Just one point before I'll move on to Alex Rowley. I think we do get the data of the positive destinations of kids leaving school, say, at the age of 17. But I think it would be really interesting if we had the data of where they were at the age of 25. So, yeah, just move on to Alex Rowley.
Okay, thank you. Good morning. Could I begin by asking, we do put quite a bit of the emphasis on COVID, but to what extent has these issues been brewing over a much longer period of time in terms of skills, the failure to deliver skills, the failure to deliver lifelong learning? Last time I looked at the UK level, there was something like 7 million people lack basic numeracy and literacy skills. So those issues, I mean, we've made progress in Scotland in terms of childcare, and the big issue that doesn't seem to be getting talked about much, Brexit. So is it a combination of a perfect storm with all these things coming and that these issues have been brewing for some time? Or can we legitimately say that the key factor here has been the pandemic? Could I maybe start by asking Jonathan your thoughts on that?
So I got a bit cut there. I had a technical issue there.
Okay.
It broke up. Could you just repeat the very last bit of the question?
Well, to what extent has these issues been allowed to brew over many years? Specifically, we don't seem to talk much about Brexit. But what is that impact? Certainly the government here in Scotland talk about Brexit in terms of there's just not the people to actually take the jobs up. Poor skills, poor education, numeracy and literacy skills, etc., etc.
Okay. Thank you. I'm terribly sorry. Brexit. Okay. So Brexit clearly is important for the economy as a whole in terms of the extra trade barriers with our nearest neighbours, in terms of productivity and in terms of, you know, the ease of immigration. And that's important for the supply side of the economy. In terms of there is some evidence that the particular high levels of vacancies, which is a real labour market problem, is exacerbated by that. But in terms of the employment and then people to in terms of the employment rate, I think it's a lot less important. The ability to potentially find skilled jobs in companies that are investing, then that could be more important. And the extent of, it's always been the case that the extent we have the harder Brexit that is going to make these things more difficult. In a sense, the way that lower investment and less trade feeds through to real people is, in a sense, in the world of less good jobs with less progression and less pay. But on the employment side, I don't think we have much evidence that that's important. I don't disagree with you that things on that skills, has been under appreciated for many years, although it's harder to know exactly what to do. There's a lot of good talk about skills, and it's much harder to, I think, pull levers, in government, whether that be in Westminster, to resolve issues there.
And what about the education system? I mean, we still have children going through a whole education system, coming out the other end ill prepared for a career in anything, and numeracy and literacy rates still a major issue. I mean, is the education system delivering for the world of work? Is it geared up to deliver for the world of work?
So, I think that the key issue that we have in the UK as a whole, compared to some other European countries, is less obvious route to good jobs and good careers for people who don't attend university. In countries like, I think that is very slowly starting to change. There have been expansions of high quality apprenticeships, but it's from an incredibly low base. And an incredibly, rapid growth from an incredibly low base is still not many. But this is in comparison to places in particular like Germany and Switzerland, which have very obvious routes for technical training, on the job learning at young ages, into really highly skilled and productive industries. And people can and do every day succeed without going to university, but the routes are less clear as they make their own way through that transition from school to the labour market.
Thank you. Marek, would you like to comment on that?
Is that directed to me?
Marek.
Or is that to me?
Marek, but I think just remember that we're focused on the inactivity retired. Sorry, Merrick.
Just very quickly on the education system front and on the skills front. There's of course an employer dimension, and there's a public policy dimension there as well. We know that employer investment in skills and training has declined. That being said, we are in an extremely tight labour market just now, and one of the key responses of employers over the last few months has actually been to try and upskill their employees. So maybe we are seeing a sort of forced shift in that direction. On the public policy front, now of course, much of this is about the balance between vocational and academic education. Now, the CIPD published a report on overqualification in Scotland just last week, which shows that the rates of graduates that are employed in sort of lower skilled, medium skilled roles has more than doubled over the last 30 years. This just points to the importance of work-based learning, apprenticeships, and all of that is, of course, underpinned by careers guidance and advice. The review that's just been published has been very good. It needs to be implemented very fast to make sure that young people understand the wide range of routes that are actually available to them in Scotland. As somebody already mentioned, apprenticeship system in Scotland is actually very good. We just need more of it.
Okay, thank you. I mean, you do say, convener, that concentrate on an activity and work, but if you believe that skills and education are actually key to that, then that's where I'm going with this.
Sure.
David, can I maybe come to yourself in terms of pensions? And so we see the state age pension going up and up and up. Now, my experience has been, firstly, that if you're in manual work, and I think in one of these papers I read the numbers of people who are in who are less skilled, less educated, those numbers are increasing, them being inactivity. But if you are in manual work and they keep putting the pension age up, there comes a point where you're just physically struggling to do that. I met with refuse collectors recently, and they were on their 50s and telling me just how difficult it was to go out and do a shift. So is there an issue there? Because, again, if we look at local government, those in the higher grades, on the higher salaries, will have massive pension pots. They actually leave generally quite young with a massive handout at the same time. But for low-paid manual workers, those options aren't available to them through the pension scheme. I mean, is there an issue there about the different professions or manual work that leads to older people not being able to access big handouts, but at the same time not physically able to work?
Yeah, I mean, just in terms of the kind of most recent experience and the study that the ONS did, the people that are leaving the workforce and not choosing to come back in are, as you say, some of those wealthy people. So something like 66% of them don't have mortgage, 61% don't have debt. So it is the sort of the wealthier, typically male, who is choosing to exit, where people are exiting at sort of 50 plus. I think there are indications that those people would want to come back to work, but may have mental well-being issues, or on, number of those people on NHS waiting lists is around 18%. So I think for the 50 plus, there are people who potentially want to come back to work, but maybe for health reasons can't. But you're right, and I think to some degree that was behind the government's agenda on freedom and choice, is allowing people to access their retirement savings more flexibly, so that, you know, when freedom and choice was introduced, the average pension pot was just under £30,000. Well, if you try and convert £30,000 into annuity, it doesn't give you enough to live on and do the weekly shop. But if you could access that £30,000 maybe 2 years earlier than the state pension age kicked in, then you could take that, you know, in equal amounts, and you may be able to leave sort of 2 years early. Now, the reality is, and maybe Jonathan and others may be able to speak to this better than I can, pre-freedom and choice, what you saw is in the run-up to state retirement age that people were leaving the workforce due to disability, illness, and so on, and, you know, bad backs and those sort of things. So the people who had very heavy manual jobs potentially were leaving the employment and claiming disability. What freedom and choice did was allow them to access their savings more flexibly and maybe have that decision.
Okay, thank you. Jonathan, I think you wanted to come in on that.
Yeah, I think two things. One is, we basically know that the higher state pension age, particularly for women, which has risen by 6 years rose by 6 years in a decade, you know, leaves women of those ages with considerably less support than they, you know, had before. The working age benefit system has been back. The pensions and state pension system has been made more generous for those who get it, and there's big divide. And you know, if you talk about the types of workers and struggling financially or with work at that point, I think there's a very good case to be made that the support for people in the run-up to state pension age needs to be looked at again, even if there is a good case for the state pension age being, you know, elevated as given, you know, extra longevity in the population, at least compared to, you know, 20, 30 years ago. In terms of pension freedoms, you know, I think there's a good case that, you know, the pension freedoms allows people to do things more flexibly, to take small, you know, to take bits out of their pension, to spend it flexibly. And it almost allows people to have a kind of portfolio of income, you know, and particularly when you've got a spouse, maybe one's working a bit, one's not, one's drawing a bit of pension, maybe they have some benefits for disability, personal independence payment, for example. You know, all of these things can combine together. I don't think we have great evidence that pension premiums per se is causing a change in employment at these ages, but it might be facilitating people's decision.
Okay, thank you. And finally, can I just quickly, Liz, can I ask you, a number of years ago I looked at, I think it was Germany and Volvo or Ford. So they had their academy. They had an academy for cleaners. Everybody in the workforce was valued, no matter what they did. But then that academy ran it in the whole supply chain. And so you had SMEs and others offering and being able to skill up and whatever. I mean, do we need to think a bit more radical here? Do we need to look at these best practices for across Europe and start to engage with employers more so that no matter where you are in the workforce, you're going to get continual lifelong learning skills, etc.? Is there any of that going on, and is that where we need to be moving?
First of all, I'll answer your question. Can I go back for a moment just to the Brexit question that you asked? Because your question was, I was waiting for somebody asking it, because Scotland had a big issue way before COVID and indeed way before Brexit. We had a massive problem with, there was just not enough people here and we weren't attracting talent in. And there's been lots of good ideas came out of the government then, new talent programmes to bring people in. And it worked in some cases, particularly in some sectors. And we also had, but when Brexit came along, we would have, if even before Brexit, we were already experiencing skill shortage areas and not getting enough people, particularly in the sectors like, and you'll know the ones I'm going to talk about. Pre-Brexit, it was the tourism, agricultural, hospitality, food and drink. Those ones that are, in a lot of cases, very manual focused, manual skills. Some people didn't want to work in these sectors. So we were having massive problems. So the influx of labour from all parts of Europe actually helped Scotland in, helped us dramatically. And then Brexit came along, and then all of a sudden, we were back to square one again. So I think that lessons learned from that, because COVID has an impact on attitudes, on health, and crisis. But we can't just, you know, say it was as a result of COVID, because it wasn't. So I think that forward planning is, and I wrote that down when you asked that question, that forward planning, because yes, there's some elements of some private sector groups already grouped together and formed their own academies, and they've been very successful, because what they're doing is, let's employ, let's retrain, let's upskill, because the skills match of individuals that are perhaps doing, you're talking about manual tasks, perhaps doing manual tasks and perhaps being forced out of the marketplace because those jobs were disappearing, or it might have been through health. But that's changed because the business model's changed, technology's changed. But what we've got to be smart at, and that is taking these individuals, because they're valuable, and looking at how we can actually look at retraining them. Now, if I'm sitting here at 60 doing that retraining, do I want it? Do I really want to retrain, or I'll just take my pension? There's a lot of people that would want, and we need to watch the language here, but I think that for both ends of the marketplace and labour, this issue about private sector pulling together and sharing. In fact, it reminds me of way back, many decades ago, when sectors used to do that and business used to do it. They trained and paid for their training. Yes, they got support from government, but these academies focused on the jobs of today and, more importantly, the jobs of tomorrow. Because had we done that 10 years ago, we probably would not have had the size and the gaps that exist right now on some skill shortage areas. You know, so I think that that model and that focus, and I can't remember who said it earlier, that focus on looking at investing in more vocational type training and investing on intelligent information, not just to the young people, but to their parents and carers, etc. Because, you know, it's fine for us to come out and say, oh, yeah, there's going to be, you know, 10,000 green jobs. sit and think, what does that look like? What does a green job look like? And it's that interpretation is important. And let's get, you know, working with our educationalists in the colleges and the universities, but let's start looking at getting private sector to do more leading in that regard, working with our public partners, but absolutely focused so that any individual, whether they perhaps didn't do so well at school, they've still got talents. And in some cases, it might be that we create that environment for them to really flourish. So I think this changing of models, we talk about let's be innovative, let's just go and do it. Because trying to work around an environment and an infrastructure that possibly needs to change faster than it's sometimes able to do so, then, you know, can we try new things? And you know what? If they fail, so what? We'll know very quickly, and let's go try something else. That's how this Scotland is going to be innovative. If we are actually all together saying, let's change the how, or let's innovate a little bit better. And I know it's hard because you've got public institutions, you've got thousands of people, and you can't just let's change the direction of the ship overnight. But I think it's an element of let's build on some new stuff that's going on.
Thank you. Thank you.
Brian, please.
Thank you. Good morning, panel. I'm going to continue on that theme. Thank you for bringing that in, Liz. I mean, one of my things I think we should be doing, we've got this green economy, this huge opportunity within the green economy, and my view is we're not weaving the green economy into our education system nearly fast enough. We have, and just last week I was in Kilmarnock College, who have apprenticeship places available. I was in some engineering works who are short of apprentices, and I come. My region is a place where there's higher levels of unemployment. So in my view, we've got all the bits and bobs there, but as I don't think we're connecting all the elements of that up. And actually, we have a huge opportunity here, I think, in the green economy. But as to your point, Liz, we're not doing that well enough. I take it that's something you would agree with.
I would, and please don't misunderstand me, because there's a lot of great people doing some great things in our schools. I did see it. No, there are. And I think that the government's programme and the Development of Scotland's Young Workforce and the recent Career Service Review, that's beginning to open up the can and saying, OK, let's look at what we have invested in. Because you've got Development of Scotland's Young Workforce all across Scotland, led by, in some cases, private sector only, led by public sector, in some cases, led by partnerships. The whole purpose of that partnership was to do just what you're talking about, get right into the system, get right into where the young people are, helping them and their peers, etc., to make this word informed choices. But we're not getting deep enough into the system. Now, whether that's because they've got a curriculum that's overloaded and can't get in, I don't know. But it needs to be revisited in terms of this, you know, that information. And I know I can hear people saying, but that would require further investment, budget cuts, et cetera, et cetera. And that's where I think we just need to be, you know, let's look at what we can do. Because there's no doubt in my mind that intelligence, if it's going in, it's patchy. And if it's going in, it's not going in a way that's helping our teachers, that's helping our lecturers, to enable them to be able to bring people into that system that can help work with our young people at a really early age to help them and advise them as much as possible. Because if we continue with this, let's have, you know, sectoral groups, let's have, we've got sector programmes, we've got skills audits. The information is there, but it's perhaps not either getting through our systems or it's not communicating in a way that, quite frankly, we can actually, you know, even I'm sitting here thinking, what does a green job look like? And I should know. You know, so I think that's important that we are looking ahead, because Scotland is seen, you know, internationally, we are seen as experts in renewable energy. We are in many, many cases. So we know that's a growth area. We know where the growth's coming from. So let's get in, and actually the academies will help on the immediate short term by taking groups and just putting them through and getting them to come out with qualifications, skills. It's going to give them a better quality of life at the end of the day, that, you know, that they're going to be able to afford to buy things, to feed their families, etc. We talk about we need to upskill Scotland's population. We need to be clear what we're upskilling them to do. So you're right. You know, we should not be sitting here with, you know, apprenticeship vacancies in something like engineering. You know, and we're and as I say, we're sitting here with other countries looking into us, saying we would like to buy your talent. And I mean, we're not going out there saying, well, we don't have all of the talent we really need, but we've got some good talent here. But let's grow our own and grow it quickly. No, and I think that that's another thing about the universities. Can we grow it quick enough? That's that vocational training that's saying, okay, we're going to do a quick 6 month, 9 month, year, and then that continual qualification will come. We need people in the marketplace as quickly as possible.
Thank you. I know B wants to come in on this, and just going to sort of add another layer onto that. I was just wondering whether we are marketing potential careers to our young people properly and giving them the vision of where they should be or where they could go to. Because I think if you, you can't do it if you can't see it, if, you know, for want of a cliche. I wonder what your thoughts are on that, Bea.
I think what I wanted to do, if that's okay, was just to kind of pick up on some of the stuff that's been said about skills and education, and just, well, there's obviously lots to say about the importance of skills and education. I thought it was maybe worth highlighting that when we look at what's driving the rise in inactivity in particular, we don't actually find that the majority of the rise seems to be being driven by people without degrees. We don't find huge differences in the rise in inactivity between people with and without degrees, or between people in professional and non-professional jobs before they move into inactivity. So just while I think skills are obviously really important things for Scotland to be focusing on in general, it's not entirely clear to me, based on the work that we've done on inactivity, that a focus on skills alone would fix what we see in the labour market right now. And I think I'd also want to kind of highlight that so much of this does seem to be driven by moves among older people in particular.
Thank you. I'm glad you've taken us into to the older market, because I think we're in a situation just now where COVID has accelerated this gap between life expectancy and the age in which we're leaving the workforce, and that seems to be a growing gap, and COVID has exacerbated that. And I wonder if I could bring Marek in here and ask him: are we again with those who are leaving the workplace early, or potentially leaving the workplace early? Are we giving them the encouragement, experience, and opportunity to develop and remain within the workforce in a manner which suits them?
Well, I think this is the crux of the issue. Actually, this is exactly what the piece of work that I did around older workers was aimed at trying to do. It was trying to explain to employers that there are certain things that they can do that might encourage older workers to stay in work a bit longer. Now, at the heart of that is flexibility. We know that older workers are much more likely to work part-time. Self-employment as well is part of that, but also have higher rates of home working, for example. So there is a clear preference there for flexibility. But if you look at the statistics, about 14% of those over 50 say they would like to work reduced hours, even if it meant pay cut. So that's a very clear unmet demand there that employers could try and accommodate by, for example, splitting job roles between two, et cetera, The other thing there, and we mentioned this time and again here, is skills and career progression opportunities. I think it's very important that employers don't come to making assumptions just because somebody is over 50 or even over 60 that they won't be interested in development of skills on this particular course, et cetera, et cetera. Now, again, a very tight labor market has now forced, to a certain degree, employers to rethink some of these things and consider their retention strategies and consider their recruitment strategies, expand their traditional sort of labor pool as well. So that's skills and careers. And then the last bit, of course, is health and well-being. And it goes without saying that the older you go up the age range, the more likely you have certain health conditions, long-term conditions, or disabilities. employers have a key role to play there in order to accommodate these conditions.
I could think for a very small one. I wanted to just to ask Liz around. It's not just around the lack of people or bodies on the ground. It's actually if the retiring earlier were draining our resources and draining our experience. COVID has. Would you agree? COVID has exacerbated that, and that's something that we really need to tackle immediately.
I think it has, Brian, because. And I think Malik used the word, again, I think about forcing employers to look at changing. We've not just changed our working models. I mean, I don't know any business that has come through COVID and not changed the way we work, how we work, and more importantly, how we look after our people. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are certain businesses that are restricted and they cannot bring in as flexible working as a lot of us would have a strong desire to introduce. But there's also a great majority of businesses that have had to change because of the experience of COVID. But we've actually been forced to introduce technology that we didn't know existed before. We've been forced to trial home working that we thought wouldn't have worked. And you know what? It did work because it actually worked in a lot of cases from a productivity point of view. It also gave us, our employees were actually more satisfied because we took some stress away, whether they were carers, whether they were looking after children, whether they had to do, you know, childcare modelling. So this flexible modelling, that's not going to reverse. If anything, I can actually see that. I know there's some statistics that are saying it's going to reverse and we're going to go back to the workplace. Some may do that. We've got to remember that some employees, some people actually enjoy going into that workplace. They get that interaction. They are still productive. So I think that balance, that balanced model is going to be here and is going to be remaining because I keep saying it, we can't afford to go back the way any longer. The model of flexible working, I mean, even when I was in Japan, the amount of businesses in Japan, flexible working, just it's a natural model. I actually believe that we're going to be forced to even become even more flexible to retain the people we've got and to get the talent that we need in this country.
Thank you.
Can I move to John Mason, please?
Thanks, convener. Yes, I mean, maybe if I can just pursue that with Dr. Cameron, is there a big difference here between large employers and small employers? Because it strikes me that some of the things we've heard from the other witnesses, you know, sharing a job, all of that kind of thing, training, reskilling while you're in employment, that will work for a big employer, but is that a problem for small employers?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you're right in that regard. There is a distinction because we talked about even career progression, you know, the corporate Scotland, if you like, bigger, better, more resource, not better, bigger, more resources to invest and more resources to be able to, you know, introduce those types of policies. So absolutely, it is easier for large businesses in Scotland to be able to do what we've just been talking about. Having said that, not all large businesses can do it. It depends on the sector, and it depends on their use of technology. And we know, I mean, obviously the financial sector, that's the obvious one, and a number of other services. They do it and are doing it well. For many small businesses, it's not possible. And the big challenge for small businesses then is, how do they compete in a marketplace? Because the talent is liquid now. It goes wherever it likes, quite frankly, because of the opportunities that are there. So I think that for small businesses, yes, it is more of a problem because, you know, they've got 4 people, 5 people, 10 people. They can't afford for someone to say, well, I'm going to work a 3-day week. It doesn't fit. Mm-hmm. But having said that, I do think that we can do more to help smaller businesses to look at how they can perhaps change some of their business modelling through business support and how we can, and in some cases it won't work. And I think it's going to be a reality check that in some small businesses, all the flexibility that we all have a desire to give to our employees, it's not possible. So I think there's a reality check there. But there's also a check that says there are a number of smaller businesses that perhaps don't fully understand how to introduce flexible working and what they need to have in place to be able to do that. You know, you'll get a business saying, well, oh, my, you know, X working from home, how am I going to evaluate whether they're working? How am I going to monitor it? Now, in today's society, we like to think that we've got trust and integrity and values, but there's individuals that will, we've got to look at that closely. So I think there's an element of what support and help and advice, and whether that's in a group scenario, you're talking about your academy training, that's in a group scenario, small businesses, that we can help them put in place different processes to enable them to be able to do this.
Okay.
But they won't all do it.
I will come to the other witnesses, but just to you've raised various ideas in my mind. But because another part of this would be support for people who maybe whose health isn't so good, and that could be long COVID,
yes,
or it could be other things.
Yes.
So is that also an issue that, you know, I mean, I would have thought employers should be providing more support in order to keep people in the workplace. Mm-hmm. But I can, if you've only got four or five employees, you know, how can you give them health support? Mm-hmm. Is there an issue in there?
Mm-hmm. I think there is, because, you know, many businesses obviously operate now with private health care. And we did a recent survey on what, you know, future employees are looking for. And the list was healthcare's up there in, you know, in the top three. That then raises an issue, is the health services, whether it's private or whether it's National Health Service, do they have the capacity to deal with the high demand? And the answer is no right now, and we're seeing that, and whether it's dentistry or whether it's in care service or whatever. So I think it's an issue there about that reach out, even when businesses do introduce it and say, OK, I'll provide healthcare up to a value of whatever. You can go and see a consultant, you can go to a dentist, whatever. The services are not there, which is maybe not for this committee, but it is an issue. But in actual fact, we did another in one of our surveys, and this was interesting. 78% of the participants actually stated that mental health and support for other health conditions should be a joint responsibility between business and governments. Now, that was interesting for me, because what does that joint responsibility look like? We need to dig a bit deeper into that. But I think that's a recognition that every business, irrespective of size, we do have a responsibility to support our employees.
Okay.
And we've got to look at ways in which the best way we can do that, and it's affordable for us to do it.
Okay. Well, I want to hear from some of the other witnesses as well. So maybe Mr. Cribb first, and then I was going to come to Mr. Zamanik. Mr. Cribb?
I just wanted to pick up on the flexibility point and how flexibility can encourage people to stay in work. You know, there's particularly if I think about the kind of, say, 50 plus population, I think there is a particular finding that work full time in their 50s and 60s are particularly likely to be dissatisfied with that. They don't necessarily want to work as many hours as they are doing so. And, you know, to the extent that it's a full time or nothing for some people, that can discourage that can encourage people to leave work. And that's, you know, not good. But, you know, have a more flexible part time role. That being said, you know, flexibility in terms of encouraging people to stay in work or stay with working with employers isn't totally kind of costless. That's because if you have a lot of flexibility, particularly on work location, there are kind of differences between people. Some people really want to be in a busy office or workplace that provides a great deal of socialization and, frankly, friendship for some people. You know, we have some evidence that at older ages that there is at least among a part of the population, a kind of discouragement about the quality of work life because there's relatively few, because working at home doesn't provide the degree of socialization that kind of everybody in the workplace most of the time provides. And, you know, there are similar issues on the kind of younger generation in terms of the amount of training, informal or formal, that they get working flexibly, where that means kind of working at home as opposed to in the workplace.
And when we're talking about flexibility, do you see a difference between large employers and small employers in that area?
I'll be honest, I don't know on that.
Okay, well, maybe that's a good one. If I could come to Mr. Zamanik, in your area, do you see differences between large and small employers?
I think there are big differences between what large employers and small employers can offer, and I think that applies to flexibility and applies to health and well-being support that you mentioned earlier as well. I mean, we know from research that large employers are much more likely to provide things like occupational health or well-being strategies in place. But also what Dr. Cameron mentioned in terms of flexibility, very often small businesses simply do not know how to navigate the system, and that can be a challenge, and that's where government and its agencies can actually play a role. If I can make one point on the whole flexibility issue, it's very important that we don't succumb to the temptation to equate flexible working with home working. There's many other forms of flexible working out there, and actually, if you ask employees what form of flexible working they would prefer, flexi time is the one that always comes up on top. So that's choosing when to start and finish your day. Compressed hours, of course, are part of that as well. Job sharing, reduced hours, etc., etc. It's not just about home working. Approximately 31% of jobs in Scotland cannot be done from home. So it's very important we focus on the other types as well.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. If I could move on to pensions, maybe with Mr. Fairs. I mean, you seem to be quite positive that somebody even with a small pension pot could take some of it, and that gives them a bit of flexibility as to what they do in their kind of probably later working life. I mean, I think the TUC have said, though, on the counter that, you know, that is just leading to people being in poverty once they're retired. And, I mean, I just wonder, are people in their 50s and 60s getting the advice they need? And also, how does that compare to other countries? Have we got more flexibility in this area than other countries have?
So just in terms of the way other countries have tackled the COVID pandemic, some countries have allowed early access to retirement savings. So in Australia, you could take $10,000 out in the first year of COVID and $10,000 in the second, and getting on for 2.5 million people did that. So something like $3.5 billion Australian dollars has been taken out of the retirement system. When you drill down to people who took that money out in full in both years, it tends to be younger people, and they have wiped out their retirement savings. So actually Australia has a different challenge in that it now has a cadre of people who have made a significant impact on their retirement wealth because of taking money out. The US did something very similar. It allowed you to take money out of the pension scheme. It removes some of the tax charges that would have applied. But in the US, they're now very worried that actually because people don't have financial resilience, they have dipped into their retirement savings, and that will impoverish them in later life. And the US is now thinking about how it can build financial resilience for people in the United States, and they may look to something like automatic enrolment, but in a saving sense to do that. In the UK, we didn't see during the pandemic people opting out of automatic enrolment. We did expect to see it, but actually we didn't. It has gone up very recently. The numbers from DWP at 1st of October show that the percentage of people opting out has gone up from 7.6% to 10.4%. So we didn't see that in the pandemic. We are now beginning to see it. If you look at people cashing out their DC pots throughout the pandemic, then it went up in the first year of pandemic. It actually then fell in the second year of pandemic, and it has now increased in the last year. So there is something that people seem to be under greater financial pressure now than they perhaps were during the pandemic. But in total, the amount of money that's been taken out from DC pots has only gone up by 5%. So there doesn't seem to be huge strain on pensions because of people dipping into pensions. Now, clearly, it will be very variable at an individual level. There are some people that very clearly have real challenges right now and may have no other choice but to dip into their retirement savings. Because, you know, if you've got to feed your children or meet bills, then you've got to look to that access. But we are concerned, you're absolutely right, we're concerned on two fronts. One is that people can be subject to scams, and scammers are very alert to some of the pressures that people are under, and so we are promoting, we issued just recently a joint statement with the FCA and MAPS, urging people that if they are accessing retirement savings to look at the signs of scams and be aware that they're vulnerable. So there's that element. But you're absolutely right. People tend to underestimate how much they need in terms of retirement savings. And for people that are dipping into their retirement savings, you know, in their mid-50s as soon as they have access, potentially they may not understand what that means in the longer term. And, you know, for the people that are dipping into their savings, they, in a sense, have kind of made their mind that they want access to the money, and they just see getting independent support from the Money and Pension Service through Money Helper as a barrier to getting their money. So we don't see as many people as we would like actually accessing the free services that are available.
OK, I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Thank you. Jim Fairley, please.
Thank you very much. We seem to have strayed a wee bit off topic through the course of this conversation, but it's been really interesting. However, I'm going to bring it back to economic inactivity in the older age group. And something that hasn't been touched on by anyone, and I may be completely left field here, but has there been any consideration given by anyone to menopausal women dropping out because there's not enough support in the workplace for menopausal women? And that's an open question to anybody who wants to stick their hand up. If there's no answer, that's fine. I'll move on. Liz, there you go.
I guess I'll go for that one. For some reason.
It clearly was not directed at you.
It's an interesting question because I think only recently we have started to have that open debate about the impacts of the menopause on women and the impacts in terms of the workplace. So I think that probably over the last maybe 12, 18 months, this has begun to become higher up the agenda. Yep. And I think it's a good thing because we talk about, you know, people being ill, sickness. This is a serious situation. And in a country where we need women retaining in the workplace to retain them and also bring others in at certain age groups. I think we've got to do more. I don't think there's been enough done because a lot of businesses don't quite know what to do, particularly small and medium-sized businesses. So we need access to more experts and more engagement with that group of individuals, either as individual businesses or as, you know, a group of people. We need to understand what we can and should be putting in place in terms to support women who are going through the menopause. And not just women, but, you know, all of us, to understand the impacts it's having and to be making appropriate changes to the workplace, to process, to hours, to whatever that's going to be necessary, because we're not doing enough.
No, and I would argue also that the medical profession need to have a far better understanding so that they can give the right advice to business as to how to actually make this work. Jonathan, I think, was it yourself that put your hand up there rapidly as well, but Liz got in first.
I have nothing to add on top of that.
Nothing to add on top of that. Right, OK. David, I'm going to come to yourself. I think you touched on it with John there in terms of what the UK pension system is doing, but I want to come to one very specific area of pensions, and that is GPs. Now, I don't quite understand what's going on, but I'm told, and that we're hearing, that younger GPs are retiring because of a pensions issue, but some of them could actually stay on for longer, but it's not worth their while staying in the profession. Now, we've heard counter to that, that some younger doctors are just tired, they're done in, and that's why they're retiring. Can you shed some light on that?
Yeah, as I understand it, it's a tax issue. So there are two ways in which the accrual of pension and access to pension is taxed. So as you build up tax year by year, there is something called an annual allowance. If you go over that, then you pay a tax on that excess amount. And then when you take your pension at retirement, if it's over the lifetime allowance, then you suffer a penal rate of tax, 55% effective tax rate. So what you find is that the first of those tests, the annual test for GPs, as they reach the later stage of their career, they get pay rises, then they are subject to a tax. Now, doctors have a choice of whether they effectively get a reduction in their pension, which effectively pays for that tax, or whether they write a cheque. I think some doctors think that the only choice they have is to write a cheque, and those cheques can be very substantial and effectively wipe out the earnings that, that they've achieved for that year. And so I think, you know, that leads them to think that they should retire, because actually it's just not worth it economically for them to do that. I think probably some of them don't understand that they've got this second option, and maybe actually sort of education and support to doctors to understand that and the long-term implications may help. But certainly, you know, I, empirically, I see that from people around me, doctors exiting because of that tax.
So in general, do UK pension freedoms, are they greater in the UK, pension freedoms greater in the UK than the other, than they are in other European countries? And is that helping drive the labour inactivity in our country as opposed to other European countries?
I mean, it's quite difficult because actually, you know, the pension system in each country is built on what the state pension is and private pensions and so on. So it's very difficult to have a sort of like-for-like comparison in that way. But I go back to what I said earlier, we're seeing probably only something like a 5% increase in terms of people accessing their pensions at the moment compared to pre-pandemic. So that wouldn't suggest necessarily, and of course people don't need to retire in order to access their pension, but wouldn't necessarily see that that is driving the inactivity.
Right, OK. If we do have a greater proportion of older workers leaving the labour market, is that going to put much more pressure on the younger age group to be able to manage that pension fund?
No, I mean, we do monitor the... and most people now are saving through master trusts. There are 36 authorised master trusts. We monitor them individually and collectively. So we have monitored through the pandemic the financial strains on those, and we're quite comfortable that they are resilient and sustainable. There is quite naturally some consolidation that's happening in that market, and I'm sure that will continue to take place, but we're quite comfortable with the sustainability of the retirement system.
OK, thank you.
That's good. Has anyone got, we've got a couple of more minutes? Any questions? No? Brian, OK? Yep.
You know me. Let me have a wee look at my papers. Thank you. Thank you.
Can you said look at your papers, Brian. David, at one point you were talking about scams there for people getting their pensions, and it's something I have to say I watch all the time on social media and retweet it. Do you as an organisation put stuff out on social media warning people about the scams so that we can pick it up and then retweet it? And I did two over the last week of scams that we know that are currently going on just now. So you do that currently?
Yep.
Right, OK. I'll let you start following you on Twitter then.
There was just one sort of almost a regional question that occurs to me, is the drain. There's a consistent drain of workforce from rural to urban. What is the impact of COVID had on that, and what do we need to do to try and stem that flow? I'll ask Liz.
Thank you for that. thank you very much for that. I think even before COVID, there's an understanding that this issue about labour fluidity in terms of movement from the urban rural areas, especially our young people moving out of these areas, and the declining population, and it covers just not only the rural, but it's our islands as well. So I think we need to just understand that that's the environment we're in. However, COVID has exacerbated that, because we have seen major geographical regional differences on the increases or decreases of the economically inactive in particular regions. And it's not all down to COVID, but it does play a big part. Some of it might be down to age population or unemployment in those areas, so that it's not a complete black and white picture in that regard. But there certainly it has an impact. And you know, what can be done about it? I don't have an answer to that, Brian, quite frankly, right now. In terms of how do we stop that flow, I think to stop the flow, we need to look at the creation of the economies in these rural and urban areas, and perhaps look at more investment in the area to try and bring more jobs in, so that we retain the people that are there, and more importantly, attract other people out of in some cases, other parts of Scotland into those who are really struggling economically, if we can do that. And I think the creation of the socio-economic agency for Dumfries and Galloway and the Borders was a good move, because they are focused completely on that area, as opposed to, you know, having that wider Scottish focus. So I think it's a tough one, and I don't know what the answers to that one, I'm afraid.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I thank the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning? I think we can all agree it's been a really fascinating session. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you on how to do that. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Good morning. We will now continue to take evidence on the inquiry, and I'd like to welcome our second panel to the meeting, Anna Ritchie Allen, Executive Director of Close the Gap, who joins us in person. Welcome. Chris Brodie, Director of Regional Skills Planning and Sector Development, Skills Development Scotland, who joins us remotely. And Anjim Clare, Policy Officer, and Jack Jones, Policy Officer from the Trade Union Congress, who also joins us remotely. Welcome, everybody, and thank you for giving us your time this morning and all your written submissions. We estimate this session will run up to about 11:30, so each member should have approximately 8 to 9 minutes to speak to the panel and to ask questions. For those witnesses who are attending remotely this morning, if you'd like to respond to an issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we will bring you in. I'm keen to ensure that everybody gets the opportunity to speak, and I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses just in the interest of brevity. Could I ask the witnesses just to briefly introduce themselves? Can we start with you, Anna?
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, committee. My name's Anna Ritchie Allen. I'm the Executive Director of Close the Gap. We're Scotland's policy advocacy organisation working on women's labour market equality.
Thank you. Can I move to Chris Brodie, please? I'm sorry, Chris, I think you're on mute.
Apologies, I think I muted myself there. I'm Chris Brodie, I'm the Director of Regional Skills Planning at Skills Development Scotland, amongst other things. I lead our evidence and impact team who provide analysis on different aspects of the Scottish economy and labour.
Thank you very much. And if I could move on to Anjim.
Hi there. My name is Anjum and I work at the TEC as Policy Officer for Labour Market and Social Security.
Thank you very much. And Jack.
Hi, Jack Jones, also Policy Officer at the Trades Union Congress, and I work primarily on pensions.
Thank you very much. And I'll just move on to questions now. And if I can begin by asking the first question. And I'm going to come to you, Anna, and it's something that my colleague Jim Fairley brought up in the last session. And I recently visited NHS Ayrshire and Arran, and it was about a menopausal support for their workforce. And 40% of the workforce of NHS Ayrshire and Arran are women of the age of menopause. Is there anything that you've seen recently that has impacted women's inactivity in the workforce due to menopause?
Yeah, I think that is an interesting question. So in terms of administrative data, there isn't that level of intersectional information that tells us about women's experiences of menopause. But we do know that it's rising, I think, in the profile is something that needs to be looked at. So as Liz said in the previous session, that certainly it's employers are a bit more interested in it than they were previously. The anecdotal evidence that's available and also evidence from grey literature suggests that it has a very significant impact on many older women's experiences of the workplace. Employer responses to it are inadequate. And because it can go on for quite a long period of time where women are at loss. And there's definitely evidence to show that some women have exited, left their jobs, are unable to work because of it. And, you know, as it's probably been explored elsewhere, much more difficult to get back into the labour market once you've left if you're older, and particularly if you're a woman.
Yep. Thank you for that. That's, I think it is an area that's very new, as we said, like in the last 18 to 24 months has been... raise a profile of it and something that we have to do a bit more work on. If I can move on to Chris from Skills Development Scotland, if I may. One thing we've touched on this morning and on this inquiry is the cost of living crisis and the financial implications this is going to have on people who are not earning money and are retired. Has Skills Development Scotland seen an increase in requests for skills training for older demographics to reflect the changing ways of working following the pandemic with flexibility and hybrid model working?
Sure. I think before I start, it's probably useful to set some context on what we do as an agency and what we don't do. So primarily, we provide a careers information advice and guidance service in schools and for adults. We deliver apprenticeships across foundation modern and graduate apprenticeships, a very small part of our service offer is actually direct training support for individuals. Having said that, looking at our service offer, our CIEG services haven't seen a huge increase in customers aged over 50 since the start of the pandemic. In terms of our modern apprenticeships, we've seen a bit of an uptick in terms of the way we cut the data is over 25s, which again is not really the age group that you're looking at, but we've seen an increase in the number of modern apprenticeships over the age of 25, but I suspect that's not in relation to older workers. The one area that the one service offer I think that or the one product that we have that might be used by older workers or older learners is individual training accounts, and the percentage of kind of individual training accounts that are taken up by the over 50s has stayed pretty much static across the since before the pandemic and after the pandemic. So I think there's something for us. We haven't seen a significant uptake and we haven't seen a significant change in the use of our services, but I suspect that may more be down to the services we offer rather than necessarily there being changes in the older workforce.
Okay, thank you. I know during this inquiry, we've also learned that there's always been an element of inactivity in the workforce and people just weren't going to work. Is there any opportunity to connect with people that probably have never worked and maybe now there is some flexibility that they might want to train through apprenticeships or modern apprenticeships if they're a bit older through Skills Development Scotland?
So again, I offer, I suppose, a couple of observations. In terms of apprenticeships, we know that employers use apprenticeships as part of their induction and recruitment for new talent. We also know that employers use apprenticeships as a means of upskilling their existing workforce. So I think it would be fair to say, indeed, I think one of our Graduate Apprenticeship of the Year winners about 3 years ago was an older worker who was using an apprenticeship to upskill. I think there's a broader challenge, I think, in terms of how people can acquire skills throughout their working lives. And the vast majority of our investment in education and training and skills actually does go on to younger age groups. It goes on to 16 to 24-year-olds, whether that's through university places, whether it's through college places, whether it's through apprenticeships. And that's not to say it's only focused on those groups, but they're primarily taken up with those groups. I think one of the things that's recognised is that we need a broader range of skills training programmes that are available for workers throughout their lives. And the importance, I think we've already heard today, of the ability to upskill and reskill is something I've talked about at Parliament to various committees in relation to both the labour market and COVID. And that's an area of priority for Scottish Government and the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. The Skilled Workforce Programme Board is looking at how a more systemic approach can be put in place for upskilling and reskilling. I think the issue of connecting people who haven't been in work back into work is a different issue. So, you know, very often people who are economically inactive in older age groups, a significant proportion of them may have been out of work for some time. I think the solutions and the support for those individuals is going to be different from those who you might be looking to upskill or keep in the labour market.
Thanks, Chris. That's helpful. If I can move on to Anjem or Jack, do you think it's likely that many workers who have taken early retirement over the pandemic will be forced back into the labour market, given the current economic outlook and the cost of living crisis that we're experiencing? And have any of these concerns been reflected through the Trade Union Congress membership at all? If I could start with you, Anjem.
Yeah, I mean, I'll talk sort of more in terms of the stats, and Jack's been speaking to some of the unions about this, just trying to get a better idea of what's actually happening. I mean, no doubt there will be some people sort of coming back into the labour market just because of the cost of living. Although at the moment, the data isn't actually showing that. The data is actually still showing that the employment group, well, employment overall is obviously less than pre-pandemic, but particularly for this age group and inactivity is still actually rising. Jack, do you want to add anything else onto that from what we've been hearing?
Can I bring you in, Jack?
Yes, please. Yeah, I think it's likely that we will see people looking to unretire in larger numbers than we've seen previously. Very few people generally do kind of come back into the workplace after they've retired. And I think one of the reasons for that is it's really difficult if you're looking for work and you're in your 50s or 60s. So that's one of the kind of the big things we need to look at now is how to remove some of the barriers that that older people face getting back into work, particularly when they've been out of work for a period. But one of the things that I wanted to say, and maybe slightly challenge one of the things that was said in the previous session, I think Alex Rowley was talking about or was asking about kind of the kinds of jobs from which people are kind of being forced to out of the labour market early because of ill health. And I think kind of the answer that David Fairs gave, I thought maybe gave a slightly too rosy impression of some of the people who are leaving the workforce early over the last couple of years. One of the things that I thought it's important to stress is that whenever we've seen kind of surveys of people being asked about how COVID has affected their retirement plans, quite a lot of people do say that their plans have changed as a result of their experience over the last couple of years, but it's always more people saying that they are likely to delay retirement as a result of that rather than to bring retirement forward. So I think we'd expect the net effect of people making kind of recent decisions about their retirement as a result of COVID to actually be an increase in activity rather than a decrease in activity because kind of people working longer rather than retiring earlier. And I think the ONS survey that David was referring to in his answer, looking at over 50s who have left the workforce over the last couple of years, I think there's quite a lot of kind of cause for alarm in there, actually. I think it was 38% of the younger people in that age group said that they were confident or very confident that they had the financial resources to meet their retirement needs, which is obviously it's a low number. And even among those kind of older people in the 60 to 65 age group, I think it was only 55%. That said they were confident or very confident. So I think this idea that people are kind of making a choice to retire early, clearly it's a factor for some individuals, but I think it's generally overstated a little bit, I think. And also in this idea that people are kind of cashing in quite small defined contribution pension pots and using that to kind of tide them over until they reach state pension age, there does seem to be evidence that that's happening, but I think that's not a good outcome. That's quite an alarming kind of situation when you think of how low our state pension is, and it's not designed for people to live off without supplementing it with a state pension. I think if people are kind of cashing in a small DC pot to kind of tide them over for maybe 2 years and then intending to rely solely on the state pension, I think that's going to cause issues when people reach state pension age and have an inadequate income and are forced to kind of to rely on pension credit to top up that income. So I think there's quite a lot of concern around the issue of people leaving the labour market early.
Yes, thanks, Jack. Can I move on to Brian Whittle?
Thank you, Gavina. Good morning to the panel. I think we're all aware that COVID has made a significant impact in change to the way in which we now work. And working practices with sort of the hybrid system. Can I just put a general question out there and say, to everybody and ask it, do you think businesses are managing to change at the pace that is being demanded by the workforce? I don't know who wants to take that one. Maybe go to you, Chris.
Thanks. I mean, I think it's an interesting question. I'm not quite sure how to approach this. I think the first thing I'd say is the pandemic has brought obvious disruption to the labour market and to the economy. I think you saw through the pandemic examples of businesses and indeed workers responding very quickly to significant changes, and pick out very obvious examples. Companies switching from plastics manufacture to PPE. Restaurant businesses moving quickly online, moving to takeaway. So I think there was a lot of change happened as a result of necessity during the pandemic. I think the pandemic has had significant effects in speeding up some underlying issues that were already underway. I think you can look at the change that's taken place in towns and city centres and Scotland and see the impact of both people switching online to retail and also the fall off of the number of people commuting into city centres is having quite a detrimental effect on some businesses that would have thought they were much more stable prior to the pandemic. I think what that kind of gets me to in terms of people in the labour market is we're in a situation, arguably we've been in this situation for quite a long time, where there's a lot of economic and labour market turmoil. And I come back to, I suspect this is a theme that I'm going to return to on a number of occasions through this discussion today, the importance of upskilling and reskilling and supporting workers to transition is going to be key for our future skills strategy. I think the importance of building kind of resilience and building the mindset into people that actually, you know, the days, if they were ever there, of there being a career for life and a job for life are gone. But I suspect, you know, we will be continually asking questions. I think over the next 5-10 years, are we responding quick enough to external challenges? And is the skills system and our training system adequately geared up to respond to what really is an unprecedented scale of change?
Thank you. If I could just develop that a little bit with Anjum, if I could. Chris brought up the issue around city centres and you know the fact that with virtual working or hybrid working, there's less footfall in city centres, which of course has had an immediate impact on a lot of city centre businesses who probably haven't managed to adapt as quickly as they need to. So in that respect, you know, city centres as COVID really put our city centres under real pressure, and what really needs to happen there? Because my view is a lot of businesses expected post-COVID to almost fall back to where they were before, and the workforce is resisting that and almost demanding that you know the hybrid working system continues.
Yeah. Honestly, I might not be the best person to answer this, but I mean, obviously, hybrid working is happening. And there has been a change in the sort of city centre, but then obviously, you know, there's been also been changes in the local area. If you're working, you know, you're no longer commuting, but then you may be sort of spending more time and money in the local area. But in terms of sort of going back to the flexible working option, you know, it hasn't actually moved as fast for everybody. It still seems to be that there are certain jobs which you can actually do from home and sort of quite set, and those that you can't. And that one of the things that we found from one of the ONS servers was it actually made it quite clear that one of the biggest things about the group who were actually inactive about returning back to work was that 58% that the flexible working was actually the most important factor for them.
Anne, I don't know if you want to come in here.
Yeah, no, I just to follow on from the point on flexible working. I mean, I think the demand for flexible working has always outstripped supply that we see in workplaces, and that has increased, I think, from COVID. So there is a bit of a story, I think, a narrative that COVID has created more flexible work. But I think that's probably not true, actually. It's much more complicated than that. Even at the peak of home working in the initial stages of COVID, from a gender perspective, it was still only about 40% of people were working from home. But most women are in jobs that can't be done from home. And so, but the availability of flexibility, it is much more nuanced and complicated. So there's home working, but as was mentioned in the previous session, we see different types, you know, and having autonomy over when you start and finish is really important. But even the last year, the flexible jobs index in Scotland, which was published, showed still only just over a quarter, 27% of jobs are advertised as being flexible. So I think there hasn't been quite resulted in the revolution that's sometimes presented as. But I would agree with what Anjum has said, in that there's this demand there, and particularly for older people, older women in particular, who have many caring responsibilities. So having older parents or doing care as grandparents or looking after a disabled person within their family, the new way of working has perhaps given a little snapshot of the flexibility that might be available. But I think we haven't quite seen a true transformational change in flexible working. And I just point out a couple of other examples. The responses that we see from employers in Scotland are very varied. So we've had some very extreme examples where some large companies have decided that everyone will now be working from home, giving up their leases on city centre offices, and everyone has to work from home. So these blanket approaches don't suit. And so what Close the Gap advocates for is a much more tailored approach to individual needs, so that, you know, everyone's got different needs according to the realities of their lives, and women have specific needs in terms of their caring roles, but I think we're quite far from that, and it's definitely having an impact on the way that people view work and whether or not they want to stay in work.
Have a good time.
Can I move to Alex? Yeah, and sure. We'll come back. Alex Riley, please.
Can I begin, maybe, Anna, with yourself and ask, is there specific sectors and is there a gender-related issue in terms of people leaving the workforce? And the one that I would highlight that we have a major problem in Scotland is social care. And it seems to be that the majority of social carers are women, the majority of social care is delivered now in the private sector, and the difference in terms and conditions and pay between the private sector and the public sector, I mean, I don't know how they get away with it. It's absolutely appalling. But people are now walking with their feet and saying bye-bye and off they go. Are these issues, and do we need to actually start to look at this for a point of view? I did put to the Deputy First Minister a number of months ago that there was a clear gender issue here, that if this was a male-dominated sector, this wouldn't be happening.
I completely agree with you. I mean, I think social care is one of these examples that we use all the time to highlight the undervaluation of the workforce, predominantly because it's women that do that type of work, so the undervaluation of women's work more clearly. But in terms of skill shortages, the low pay and the poorer terms and conditions that are associated with social care work are absolutely a driver of the skill shortages within that sector. I think also we need to think about who's working in social care jobs as well, and the link between socioeconomic background, the age of people, and the intersectional or trying to get an intersectional picture about the types of workers that are in there. But social care work, in addition to being increasingly more skilled and more technical, it's physically demanding as well. And so there's also links with women from lower socioeconomic backgrounds and having poorer health outcomes. So I think all of these factors come together to contribute to skills shortages in sectors where women work, and also will affect women's economic inactivity rates. Because what we know is the sectors which are female-dominated, or jobs which are predominantly done by women, such as care, leisure and other services, sales and customer service, there's a higher number of women working in them, but also there's higher levels of economic activity from people that work in those sectors. So there's something to be said there about job quality and increasing the pay and terms and conditions there, and taking better care of women in particular that work in those sectors in order to retain them in the labour market.
OK, thank you. And Jack, I think you were about to come in on that, Jack.
It's something that we've been kind of we've been monitoring for quite a while pre-COVID. We found that probably the biggest divide is kind of in terms of who is being forced out of the labour market early, certainly because of ill health. It is the kind of what kind of job are you doing? And it's people in low-paid work and kind of manually intensive work who are by a distance kind of much more likely to be forced out of work before they reach their pension age because of ill health. And that's primarily people in what are classed as elementary occupations, which includes things like cleaning, security guards, call centre work, that kind of thing. And then people doing more kind of manually intensive work, like potentially tradespeople or people working with heavy machinery, that kind of thing. Interestingly, when we look at gender, it's one of the few things that's quite evenly divided. There's no big difference kind of on aggregate between men and women when it comes to leaving the labour market early because of ill health. But where there is a big difference is in older women leaving the labour market because of caring responsibilities. And that is it's a much smaller number than people who are leaving the labour market because of ill health, but it's significant, and that is extremely gendered, and that's that is mostly women. And it is, again, it tends to be women in lower paid kind of work.
OK, thank you. Can I move on to that skills agenda? and maybe start with yourself, Chris, but in the last panel, I did raise that in some European countries, you have brilliant examples. So Ford do it, Volvo, what the big car manufacturers, where they've set up academies. And those academies are not just for their own workforce, and crucially within that workforce, it's for everyone. So in Germany, I once looked at an academy that was purely for cleaning, and the cleaners were the best qualified probably in the world. But it was also for SMEs. It was the supply chain. It was the whole thing coming together so that the employer took responsibility and pushed that out there. Is there much that we can learn from that here? And also, given the TUCs on the call, the role of trade unions in lifelong learning, I know the TUC's done a lot of work over the years in terms of lifelong learning, union learning, etc. But is there more that employers and unions coming in partnership with government should be doing to actually ensure that people have the opportunity throughout their life to reskill as and where required, and to get general, I mean, numeracy and literacy, 7 million people in this UK lack the basic skills in numeracy and literacy. Is there more that we should be doing in a partnership approach? Do we need new policies?
So there's quite a lot in that question, Mr. Rowley, so I'll try and work through that in part. From where you started, just in terms of, you know, kind of learning from the German model, we've spent a lot of time looking at the German model in relation to apprenticeships, and there's probably a couple of things that I would pick out there. I think in apprenticeships are valued as a kind of equal route of developing kind of high level skills as, say, a university course and a college course, and that's something that we've been working very hard in Scotland to get that kind of parity of esteem. I think the apprenticeship system in Germany tends to go to much higher qualification levels than we've traditionally done in Scotland. So, you know, you get master qualifications equivalent to a master's degree. Again, we've looked to introduce some elements of that best practice in relation to the introduction of graduate apprenticeships. So I would agree, I think there's lots to learn from Germany. In terms of that academy model, I'm not familiar with the model that you're referring to, but I think the notion that you're getting at in respect of, you know, employers or groups of employers, you know, taking responsibility for ensuring that their own kind of supply chain of people is met is absolutely one which I personally subscribe to, and one which I think we put a lot of effort on in Scotland. Another part of my team works very closely with different industry leadership groups, including health and social care, including in engineering, life sciences. We're doing some work with the retail sector at the moment. And at the heart of that work is to understand, you know, what are the future skills requirements of those different industry sectors, and to what extent are, you know, the working conditions in some cases that are on offer contributing to some of the skill shortages. So, you know, that notion of partnership between employers, trade unions and government, I think is something that is really important and a central part of, you know, how we approach the skills challenge in Scotland at the moment.
Thank you. And John, would you?
I think this was one more for Jack, sorry. Yeah.
Okay, Jack.
Yeah, I think kind of the first thing to say is that the kind of the high level, there's just a really obvious issue of not investing enough in skills. I think we spend about half the EU average on workplace training. So kind of the good news there is that it's kind of, there's a lot that can be done to improve that. I think, yeah, the kind of the social partnership model, which is common in a lot of European countries, where it is employers and unions coming together to set kind of a strategic direction for that kind of investment. Is obviously something that we absolutely should take, and we should develop here. I think, and also there's the question of how do you access the skills as well, which is kind of it's a whole separate kind of issue. I think is that what are the mechanisms for identifying training needs and for kind of pointing people in the right direction? And that's something where I think there's kind of the government has been looking at, you know, with kind of some enthusiasm at like midlife MOTs, which, I mean, the feedback we get from members is, I mean, they hate the name for a start. It's kind of, it's not a positive way of thinking about people. But as a concept, it's got pretty widespread support that you need some kind of mechanism to allow people to kind of take stock of what their training needs might be if they're going to kind of stay in employment into older age, and then kind of give them access to the training that might be needed, if, you know, either to kind of stay in their current role or if they're in a job which they may not be able to. They might not be able to do as they get older, which will help them kind of change positions. And also, I guess one thing that is worth actually flagging up is the role in the past of the Union Learning Fund, which has provided a really good vehicle for people to get training they needed, mostly kind of basic training in things like literacy and maths in the workplace. And I think kind of we've had audits of that. We found that kind of for every £1 spent on it, it delivered over £12 in kind of economic benefits, and that was obviously scrapped last year, I think. So, I mean, obviously, a key priority for us is kind of looking at that and getting something like that reinstated.
Great.
Comment on this.
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to follow up on the skills intervention points, actually. I mean, I think in terms of thinking about how to get women back into the workforce or enabling women to change careers, the offer that's available just now is inadequate, both in terms of the skills interventions that we see, but also in terms of employability. And I think there's commonalities across there, but in particular, neither of them take into account the gendered barriers to the labour market, but also to skilling and retraining. So we see where these interventions are in place, they're designed by default, they reinforce occupational segregation, which if women do participate in them, then they end up funneled into low-paid stereotypical work. We don't see adequate support for women with childcare payments to provide support with that and for travel costs, particularly if they're already living in poverty. They don't take account of women's experiences of men's violence, for instance, domestic abuse and economic abuse, and how that prevents women from participating in the labour market. And I suppose on the reskilling point in particular, because women are more likely to be in low-paid and part-time work, and those are the types of workers who are least likely to have access to training and reskilling. But it's really difficult, or it can be quite difficult, to change career, particularly if you're wanting to do something that is non-traditional, change into something. So as I think Chris had mentioned, modern apprenticeships, there's an age barrier there, which I think is a real barrier to reducing occupational segregation, because people are more likely to do non-traditional jobs when they're older as well. And so there's some really systemic challenges there to addressing occupational segregation. So what we need to see in Scotland is these skills interventions that recognise the way that women engage with training and skills acquisitions, recognise the gendered barrier to the labour market, particularly women's caring roles and how they influence the way that they participate. And that, I would say that was the case particularly with the green skills agenda, because there's certainly a very high level ambition to enable women and other underrepresented groups into green skills agenda, but there's nothing to make that happen. There's no targeted action in order to actually go to those women to try to upskill them in that way. So it's unlikely to be, I think, creating more women within the green skills jobs.
Thank you, that's very helpful.
Jim, can I move on to you, please?
Yeah, OK, right. Didn't have a surprise there, convener, thank you. I'm going to stay on that point with yourself, Anna. I think it was part of your submission, you talked about men are more likely to, and this ties in with something that Jack said earlier on, that people who are coming out of the labour market at an older age, men and women, the numbers are relatively stable or relatively similar. But men are more likely to be able to come out of the labour market because they can afford to, which indicates to me that women coming out of the labour market is because they're being forced to. So what's forcing them out of it? I think you've touched on the fact that it could be caring responsibilities. But then we're kind of putting women in a position then where they're relying on their male partner to be able to allow them to not work. Is that your understanding of that?
Well, in some cases, that might be the case. I think it's probably a bit more complicated than that. But I think that women's caring roles do reinforce financial independence on a male partner, and particularly where there's an assumption that household income is distributed equally between men and women, which is not the case, as we know. But certainly women's caring roles definitely shape the way that they engage with the labour market, contribute to women's higher levels of economic inactivity. That is the single biggest factor which drives women's economic activity. As women get older, they're more likely to work part-time, not just because they've got children to look after, because that burden falls mainly on women still, but also what we see now is this sandwich generation of caring, where older women are also likely to have caring responsibilities for older parents or for an older family member, say. And because the labour market is so inflexible and it's quite difficult to find flexible quality work which fits in with these caring roles, it means that many women are forced into taking the only types of part-time work that they can find, or else if it's financially viable, or even if it's not financially viable, have to leave the labour market. And I think what that means in terms of skills is that many women are working in jobs below their skill level, which has an impact on the labour market, on individual employers, but also on the economy.
OK. Jack and Anjum, you both want to come in this point. I'm going to come back to you, though. No. Either or, you choose.
Andrew, after you.
Okay, might have been the same thing anyway. I just wanted to sort of say that the data that we actually looked at, we apart from gender, we also looked at ethnicity as well. And we found that although the inactivity levels for BME workers were slightly lower than sort of for white workers, the main difference was the fact that they were more likely have left the labour market because of health rather than sort of like early retirement, suggesting that sort of being forced out of the labour market. And also in terms of caring responsibilities, we also found that was higher, but the major issue there was actually health.
Okay, Jack, you got anything to add to that, or is that the same point?
Yes, I have. This might be a little bit of a tangent, but I mean, one of the things that we have been highlighting a lot in the last couple of years is the gender pensions gap. And it's huge. Kind of the income gap between men and women in retirement currently is just under 40%. So it's a lot bigger than kind of the gender pay gap. And it's a very long term kind of project to close that. But I think it's a very relevant the question of kind of I guess whether women can afford to retire before estate pension age if they want to, or just kind of whether they have the resources to kind of to manage that transition from working to retirement in a way that gives them control over how they do that. And I mean, we've done quite a lot of work on it and have quite a lot of policy around it. I mean, the primary ones are actually around kind of whole of career experience and how do you make sure that women either don't have to take as much time off as they do, or, you know, the kind of care responsibilities are quite so gendered, or kind of how you try and stop those from being having quite such an impact on people's workplace pension savings. Actually, it might be slightly off topic here, but I think if people are interested, I can go into more detail or kind of send something, a written submission on that.
Okay, that might be worth some coming back to, but I'm going to come back to yourself, Anna, on what we're talking about in terms of skills, training for women, the opportunity to progress. If you looked at the CPID paper that we had earlier on, I mentioned this in the previous panel, the age group of people who believe that progression and training opportunities, the actual statement was, my job offers good opportunities for career progression, it's the 50 and beyond who actually still feel as though their jobs are offering them good opportunities to progress. So that doesn't quite chime with what I'm hearing here just now, that there aren't the opportunities for women to progress in the workplace. So do they need to break that down into a more gendered survey, or Can you expand on that at all?
I mean, if that's just one number without disaggregating the data, I would say yes. So something that we always advocate for is identifying the gender breakdown of data, intersectional data wherever possible. Because I think other evidence, and I'm not sure what survey that is, sorry, other evidence does show that there was a bit of research done which was published by the Fair Work Convention recently, looking at women over the age of 50 for their pay and progression, which I think tells a different story to what you'd mentioned there, which is either opportunities for progression were limited, but also there was less interest from women. But I think what we know generally about how older women talk about their experiences of the workplace is that being often overlooked for promotion and progression opportunities, being in a part-time role as well. I think generally we see assumptions in many organisations about part-time workers being less committed. But to go back to the flexibility point, it's difficult to progress into senior roles if you're looking for particular types of part-time work. So I think it probably needs to be unpicked a little bit to really work out what those gender differences are.
OK. Jack, do you want to come in on this bit?
Yeah, so certainly it also needs to be unpicked by sector as well, because we've done studies in the past of sectors like retail and I think accommodation as well, and just found that kind of the progression prospects are just almost zero in those sectors. They're really appalling. And obviously, they are sectors that tend to have slightly younger workforces as well. So I think there's probably a degree of kind of what sector people are working in that's going to influence how they would respond to that kind of question significantly.
OK, thank you. I'm going to move on. Again, going back to the point of this session today is working out why people are leaving the workforce. And I want to bring in long COVID. You've got some very specific views on the what we need to do with long COVID, Anna, is that right?
I mean, I suppose one thing to say about long COVID is that we don't have enough data on it. But what we do know about the way that it affects people is women are more likely to have long COVID. They're also concentrated in those sectors that were more exposed to COVID. And as workers, we're more likely to contract long COVID. I think we haven't really seen adequate responses from employers and supporting women and other workers that do have long COVID. And there's probably still a lot to find out about the longer term impacts of that. But I think in terms of the way that employers have responded to long COVID and treating it as a disability, that we haven't seen good enough responses in that area. And so we would like to see more reasonable adjustments made for women who have long COVID in the workplace.
Anybody else want to come in on that? Nope. Thank you.
Thank you. Move on to...
Yes.
Sorry. Who did we miss?
Was that Chris wanting to come in?
Yes, please. Sorry, I dropped an R on the sidebar there. I begin kind of agreeing with something that Anna said about the importance of kind of granular data and the importance of intersectionality. And the data doesn't always give you that, particularly in terms of economic inactivity. However, I want to kind of major in or focus in on some of the data that we do have about what's happened to economic inactivity in Scotland before the pandemic and after the pandemic. You know, so in 2018, about 760,000 people economically inactive. That went up to 830,000 in 2020. It's fallen back, but it's still higher than it was prior to the pandemic. We've got 790,000 people economically inactive. If you look at what's been driving the change, the reasons that people are stating why they're economically inactive, the big changes are in long-term sick. An extra 25,000 people saying they're economically inactive because they're long-term sick. An additional 7,000 people saying they're economically inactive because they're short-term sick. The committee's interest, I understood, was around kind of the over 50s, and that pattern's slightly different for the over 50s. So the number of over 50s, we have seen a big increase in economic inactivity in the over 50s, around about 25,000 people. But The increase there has been in about 5,000 additional people saying they're looking after family or home or a family member, 7,000 short-term sick and 12,000 long-term sick. The numbers who have said they're economically inactive because they've retired has remained flat. If the question that the committee is interested in is what can we do to address early retirement, my kind of challenge back would be that I'm not sure that that's the bigger issue, the bigger problem. The bigger issue is what you do about addressing, I think, in two dimensions. Of those people who are long-term sick and short-term sick, a significant proportion of them would like to find a job. And they'd find a job if the right support was available or the right sort of job was available. I think there's a second bigger issue that 80% of people who are economically inactive are not currently looking for a job. But if you break that down, out of that, just under 800,000, we think there's about 150,000 people who, if the right support was in place and the right support was in place for employers, they could be encouraged back into the work. For retirees, that's a very small number. It's only 2% of those who've taken early retirement have said that they would like to take another job. So I'm kind of ask the committee to be thinking about where it can have traction on the challenge.
Moving on to John Mason, please.
Hey, thanks very much, Convener. We've covered quite a lot of ground, so I might just touch on one or two issues that have already been touched on. You make the point, Ms. Allen, that the phrase economically inactive may not be the best one. I just wanted to ask you a bit more about that, because some women especially are very active, but they're not being counted as economically active because they're not in being paid for it. So do you think, is there a fundamental problem here with the way we do the statistics and things?
I think that there's a fundamental flaw in mainstream economics, which doesn't recognise women's unpaid work as productive to the economy. And so the international system of accounts shows that when you're caring for someone, when you're doing housework, when you're taking out the rubbish, all of these things, says that you're at leisure. Which I think anyone doing those things thinks they're probably doesn't feel that they're at leisure. And so it's really important. This is an underpinning concept in feminist economics, which is about valuing women's work, but making sure it's counted. And so the term economic inactive doesn't quite... So being inactive, if you're caring for someone or you're taking time out of the paid labour market to do other types of work, doesn't quite capture that, because it perhaps suggests you're maybe lying on your stee watching Netflix, which you're probably not doing that. So I think there are some fundamental problems in the way that we frame economic activity and who's productive and who's not productive, and what it means to be doing the work of caring for other humans while also doing work in the paid labour market.
Okay, that's helpful, thanks. And long COVID was mentioned as well, and we just had quite a brief answer that maybe employers should be doing more to support workers and especially women with long COVID. Could you expand on that, and what kind of help do you think, what should employers be doing?
So I suppose it really does vary by sector, and it depends on people's jobs. So because women are significantly more likely to have long COVID, but also because they work in those sectors where there has been a really high rate of long COVID in particular. But I suppose it depends on, it's not as if the impact of long COVID is the same on a person every single day. And it's about employers taking more of a responsive approach to meeting the needs, because if it's about 1 in 10 people with long COVID that I stopped working, but mostly on sick pay, that really does, I think, need a bit of focus in terms of working out what individual women and other workers need in order to carry, because employers should want to retain the skills of valuable people within the workforce. First of all, recognising the significance. So there have been calls, I know from the TUC and others, and we would support those, to recognise long COVID as a disability under the Equality Act. So we would support those calls. But it does, I think, contribute contribute to this wider picture where a lot of employers don't have the capacity or the competence to effectively implement reasonable adjustments for disabled women and for disabled people more generally. So I think it really is about being responsive to what individual workers want and what they need to do their job well and to keep them in the labour market.
OK, well, thanks for that. Ms Clare, could I maybe come to you with the TUC? I mean, are you agreeing with basically what was said there? Are employers just not doing enough? And should there be some kind of enforcement on employers?
Yeah, I mean, long COVID, unfortunately, is obviously sort of been here to stay. So there needs to be an adaptation to this. And we need to know more about the long COVID as well, the bit more of analysis and research into the area, because it's still actually sort of quite early days. Because when we actually start doing the data breakdown, it's quite hard. There's no sort of, you know, there's no response to I'm off, I'm inactive because I have COVID. It just tends to be a list from a main sort of like health condition. So we certainly need to know more about this as well.
And I mean, would your feeling be that employers, I mean, would it be the case then that larger employers are perhaps a bit more sympathetic and able to adapt, whereas smaller employers are less tolerant? Or is it not as simple as that?
It's sort of like pretty complex, and I don't sort of it's actually my colleague who's actually been looking at unfortunately I don't know the ins and outs, but I can check with them because they have actually done some work on this recently and get back to you with that.
Yes, I think that'd be helpful because I mean some of you when I read your evidence, you know, it did suggest that maybe some employers are not actually adhering to the law, let alone anything else. When it came to health and safety, which would presumably cover this as well.
Yeah. And I think also at the time of COVID, I mean, you know, when we, although I think there's other health issues which are rising, the number of people leaving the labour market because of health. But if you've already got an existing health condition, then obviously you were more wary of COVID at that time. But as I said, we had to actually have a report on that, so I'll get that to you.
Okay, thanks. And I mean, you know, on a slightly different angle, but related, I mean, I don't know if it's too blunt to say, but would you say some employers are actually biased against older workers and older recruits?
Personally, I think so, but I don't actually have any evidence to sort of give you a hand. I don't know if, Jack, if you've got anything to add here.
I mean, just a yes. Just, I mean, clearly, kind of, there is a lot of ageism in the labour market, and anecdotally, the stories I hear of certainly of people looking for work once they're over 60, a lot of them are heartbreaking. Kind of just the kind of those are people sending off hundreds and hundreds of applications and not getting a single kind of interview off them. And obviously, there is a degree of kind of, is that because these people are being failed by skills policies and things like that? It's also, it's clearly, it's kind of, it's attitudes of employers is definitely a factor.
Can I bring
you
in?
Yes, sorry, yes.
I just wanted to follow up from what Jack was saying. I mean, I think there is evidence definitely of ageism within the workforce, but particularly of interest is that intersection with gender and what it means for older women in the workplace who definitely speak about experiences of being overlooked for opportunities, for being undervalued in the workplace, for having less access to training and development and so on. So there is quite a bit of evidence around that and on ageism more generally, definitely.
OK, and Mr Brody, you wanted to come in as well?
Yes, I wanted to go back to a comment that Anna made, which I absolutely agree with, that, you know, traditional economics doesn't take into account the value of the contribution of unpaid work, particularly from women. Coming back to economic inactivity, in the way it's currently framed, economic inactivity does have quite a binary meaning. And I think the qualification that Anna provided is really helpful, actually. You know, it's a distinction between are you undertaking paid work in the economy or are you not? I think there needs to be a bit of nuance in terms of understanding that technical definition or that technical characterisation of economic inactivity. And looking at the data, I think where it gets really quite interesting, quite challenging in terms of policy responses is the reasons that people are not engaged in paid work are quite complex and sometimes overlapping. So there are no simple policy solutions. Really importantly, at a time when Scotland's facing and has been facing significant challenges in terms of its workforce pressure. I think our economic inactivity rate is too high and we need to do something to address that. If we're looking to do that in the short term, some people who are economically inactive would be happy to find paid work if they had the support to do so, and if the type and the quality and the nature of employment fitted with their skills and fitted with their circumstances. So I think there's a bit for me in the same way that I think Anna's quite rightly been lasering in on the challenges that women face in the workplace. I think we need to, in getting back into work, I think we need to look at the economically inactive as quite a diverse group with a diverse set of challenges, and that the support for them should be based around their needs.
And so who should be leading on that support? Is that the employer or Skills Development Scotland or who?
So Skills Development Scotland at the moment are not delivering. We've not been asked by government to operate in that area. I think that's a policy decision for government. I know that again is an area of interest around the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, where it recognises that for Scotland's economy to be thriving, to be a wellbeing economy, we're going to need to engage more people in the workplace. I think that's a place where government can and will show leadership.
Okay, thanks. And Mr Jones, I think you were going to say something.
Yeah, partly just to absolutely agree with everything Chris has just said, actually. And also the idea that kind of the economically inactive, it is quite a kind of, within that group, it's quite fluid whether people are kind of saying they are retired or not working because of ill health. So I think kind of you've got to recognise that it's not necessarily a kind of a stable situation where people say, I am retired, and that's kind of a fixed status. But just one thing I wanted to flag up as a kind of a potential area of concern is the impact on individuals of kind of becoming economically inactive as opposed to unemployed. Because obviously, in terms of kind of building up pension for later in life, at that point, you stop kind of accruing your workplace pension, so you stop kind of saving for retirement at that point. But also, if you're economically inactive rather than unemployed, it's quite likely you'll also be kind of missing out on your national insurance credits as well. So you'll also potentially start building up your state pension as well. So there's definitely kind of a degree of concern there that aside from kind of issues which might be caused for individuals by being economically inactive in their 50s or 60s, there's also that kind of, it's possibly creating further issues down the line for when you actually reach state pension age in terms of both your kind of resources personally in your workplace pension, but also the degree to which you can access the full state pension.
Yeah, I think that's very helpful to make these points because there's obviously quite a lot of repercussions. We could probably explore that further, but I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Can I move on to supplementaries? Brian, did you want to come back in?
Thanks.
No? Any other member would like to make any other comments, questions? Okay. All right. Thank you so much for your to all the witnesses this morning for all your evidence and giving us your time. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do that. The committee will undertake some informal engagement sessions before we conclude the evidence session. Evidence taken on the inquiry on the 8th of December. Then we will hear from the Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and for the meeting to move into private. Thank you. Thank you.